Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Today, we're going to cover Lecture 8, Section 3.2, which is on conditional probability. Let's get started. Okay, so conditional probability. And this is 3.2. We're in chapter 3 now. So the idea of this concept is you have two events. Let's call them E and F. Okay, and F will be known as the condition. And the question we're going to try to answer, what is the probability of E subject to F holding? So in other words, and maybe the better way to say this is given, usually the way it's stated is given F or conditional to F. So that's the question. Okay, we want to formulate what that means. And so let me start off with an example. E will be the event of getting lung cancer. So in the general population, there is an event, getting lung cancer, and there's a risk involved with getting lung cancer. Now, F could be the event, the condition, is the event of being a smoker. So, we could think of the question as saying, what's the probability of getting lung cancer subject under the conditions of being a smoker? In other words, what's the probability of a smoker getting lung cancer? So that's the kind of question. So this is different than the probability of anybody in the general population getting lung cancer. We're restricting ourselves to just the population of smokers. So this is the condition imposed on the problem. Okay, so now what I'd like to do is formulate what it means, this conditional probability business, in terms of what we know already. So let me save the screen and clear. Okay, so here's the definition of conditional probability. So we write EF as the event E subject to the condition F. We write it, this is what that means, and this is defined, this is the definition. You take the probability of E intersect F over the probability of F. Now here's a way to think of this in terms of Venn diagrams. Suppose you have E and suppose you have F, then the overlap, which is E intersect F, is indicated in the shaded region of my drawing. So what you're doing is you are effectively change the sample space to F and looking at the probability of E intersect F inside F. That's sort of the idea of conditional probability. So it's kind of a relative probability, some people say. Okay. So I'm going to consider some examples now. Let me save the screen. Okay. So let's do the following example. Suppose you have a neighbor named Greg, and he has two kids. Say one of the kids is a boy named Joe, let's say. What's the probability that Joe's sibling is also a boy? So let me first, here's the solution. Let me first indicate what the sample space is in this case, S. Joe has two kids. There's an oldest kid, we'll list first, and then there's a younger kid. So in the general sample space, if you have two kids, you would have BB. So boy, 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 girl. So that means the oldest sibling is a boy and the younger one is a girl. Then you have girl, boy, and then you have girl, girl. Now in the case of Joe, so let's look at the event because Joe satisfies a condition. So this is the condition. It's only three out of the four listed above. Boy, 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 girl. Oops. And girl, boy. And the girl, girl case doesn't occur in Joe's case because Joe has at least one boy. Now we want to know that when Joe has two boys, so that would be the event BB. Okay, so we're interested in the condition that Joe has two boys. Joe has two boys given that he has, I'm sorry, the Greg, not Joe, Greg. Greg is the neighbor. E is, we're looking at Greg here. We want Greg to be, this is Greg's situation. We want the probability that Greg that a certain person has two boys given that he has one boy. So that would be the probability of E conditional to F. So that is the probability of having boy, boy, given that there's at least one boy in the family of two kids. Okay, so that we can solve using the definition. We have the probability of E intersect F divided by the probability of F. Now E intersect F is just E, and each one of the outcomes in the sample space has a probability of 1/4, right? So the numerator of this fraction is 1/4, and the denominator is the probability of F, which is 3/4 of the entire sample space. So it's 3/4. So the answer is 1/3. So that's the solution to this problem. Okay. Okay. So that is an example of conditional probability in action. Now, there's a way to read the formula differently, the definition differently. There's something called the multiplication rule, which is also very useful. Goes like this. So there are two forms of, there's the basic form, which is easier to remember. So you have two events, E and F, in the basic form. And if remember that the conditional probability of E condition to F is the probability of E intersect F over the probability of F. Okay, so if we solve for the probability of E intersect F by cross multiplying, we see the probability of E intersect F is the probability of E conditional to F times the probability of F. And this is called the multiplication rule. Okay, so let me give you an example of that in action. So suppose we have 7 fuses. And five of the fuses are good, and 2 are defective, but we don't know which. So what we do is we test the fuses, test randomly without replacement. Okay, so the question is, what is the probability? So let's find the probability of detecting the defects in 2 tests alone. Oops. So we don't have to perform anything more than 2 tests. What's the probability of actually being economical with testing, in other words? Okay, so let's let F, this is going to be our condition, be the event of finding the defect in the first test. And let's let E be the similar event, defect found in the second test. Oops. Handwriting is bad. Okay, so what do we want? We want the defect to be found after performing 2 tests. Well, what does that mean? That's the event EF, or I should say FE, but whatever. So that means the defect is found in 2 tests. And what is that given by? Well, it's given by the multiplication rule, the probability of E condition to F times the probability of F. Okay, so what is that? Well, first of all, let's compute the probability of finding the defect in the first test. Okay, so we have 7 fuses, so 7 fuses total, which I've already written, and so we're randomly selecting a fuse. What's the probability in randomly selecting a fuse in finding a defect? Well, there is 1 out of 7. Okay. Well, now we're not replacing the fuse. Now there are 6 fuses to consider, and we want to know the probability in those 6 fuses of finding a defect. Right, so that would be 1 out of 6. That would be the E condition to F, right? The probability of that is 1/6, 1/6. So the product of these numbers is 1 out of 42. Well, let's see. Oops, I made a mistake. I have to retract what I wrote. The probability of F, there are 2 defective fuses. So it's 2 out of 7. And so on the first try, and now we've removed a fuse, so there are 6 fuses left, and we've already removed a defective fuse. One of the one we removed is defective. So what's the because that's the condition. So what is left is 6 fuses, only 1 which is defective. So the probability is 1/6. So this becomes 2 out of 42, or 1 out of 21. So that's the solution to that problem. Okay. Okay, so now we're still in the multiplication rule, but there's the general case. Suppose I have a bunch of events, E1, E2, maybe N of them. And I'd like to compute the probability of all of them happening at once. So in other words, E1, E2, all the way up to EN. And the solution, the multiplication rule in this case, which can be derived from the one we just proved by the so-called principle of mathematical induction. I won't do the derivation, it's a pain. But it's probability of E1 times the probability of E2 conditioned to E1 times the probability of E3 conditioned to E1 and E2. So E1 intersect E2. And then you keep going. And the last term is the probability of EN subject to all the others holding. So let me do an example. So we have a standard deck of 52 cards. And we draw 4 cards from it. Randomly without replacement. Okay, so I want to find the probability that no pairs occur. Okay, so in the 4 cards I've drawn. So what do we define? Let EI be the event that no pairs occur after drawing I cards. Okay, and what do we want? We want P of E4. That's what we're asking for, that no pairs occur after drawing 4 cards. So note that E4 is the same thing as E1 all the way up the intersection of all the conditions. That's because EJ is contained in EI if I is less than J. So that's clearer because, for example, if EJ happens, then so let's say I is 5 and J is 10. So if E10 occurs, then in the 10 cards drawn, no pair occurs. But that implies that no pairs have occurred on drawing 5 cards, for example. Okay, so now what's the probability of E4? Well, that's going to be the probability of the intersection E1 through E4. And that's the same thing as the probability of E1 by the multiplication rule, the probability of E2. Subject to E1 times the probability of E3 subject to E1 and E2, but we saw that's the same as E2 times the probability of E4 subject to E3. So we have to compute these 4 numbers. Now the probability of drawing not drawing a pair on the first draw is a probability of 1 because 1 card has only been drawn, so there's no pair. So the probability of that is 1. Now, what's the probability of E2 subject to E1? That means after drawing 2 cards, no pair has occurred. In other words, that's the same as the probability of E2 in this case. So what does that mean? So I have a first card, which is 1 out of 52 that's drawn. And in order to not get a pair, I have to throw away all the cards in that denomination, which means I only have 48 choices out of the 51 cards that are left in the deck. So it's 48 out of 51 choice is the probability of E2 subject to E1. Now let's go to drawing three cards. Well, we're assuming that there are no cards drawn in the, that are pairs drawn in the first two cards. What does that mean? It means I have only 49 cards left, 50 cards left in the deck. So that's going to be the denominator of my fraction. And now in my first draw, I draw a card, and then I have to throw out, in order to look at what's remaining, I have to like not consider all the cards in that denomination for my first card. So that throws away four cards, which is 48. And then in my second draw, I'm selecting out of 48 cards, but I have to also throw away all cards in that denomination. So there are now 44 cards left to choose from. And lastly, so that's the probability of E3 subject to E2. What is the probability of E4 subject to E3? Well, there are now 49 cards to draw from total. And now none of those cards, after having looked at my first three selections, that causes three denominations to be avoided to draw a card that doesn't make a pair. So that gives me 40 cards left over, because 52 minus 4 times 3 is 40. So the product of these numbers is the answer, and you can calculate what you get. It's 0.676. About 68% of the time, you're going to luck out and not draw a pair. So that's the solution to this problem. Okay, so I'm going to end today's lecture with some useful formulas that'll prove even more useful next time, so in conditional probability. The book does not emphasize this, but I think it's a good idea to do it now. Okay, so S is the sample space. And then we have events E and F in what follows, okay? So the first statement is that if we look at the conditional probability of the entire sample space subject to condition F, well, that's going to be the probability of SF divided by the probability of F, which is the probability of F over the probability of F, which is 1. So that's the first statement, okay? So now suppose we have, say, two events, E1 and E2, and they're mutually exclusive. So E1, E2, is the empty event. Okay, and so what is the conditional probability of E1 union E2 subject to F? So here's a picture of what's going on. So you have E1, you have E2, and then you have F somewhere. Here's F. And we're looking at two different overlaps. The overlaps don't overlap. So if we take the definition of conditional probability, that would be the probability of E1 union E2 intersect F divided by the probability of F. And that's going to be equal to, I'll do it over here, the probability of E1, is, remember there's the distributive law, E1 intersect F union E2 intersect F, and that's over the probability of F. Now, these are the two overlaps, E1 intersect F and E2 intersect F. So, and those overlaps don't overlap. So this is the same thing as the probability of E1 intersect F plus the probability of E2 intersect F. Okay, so divided by the probability of F. And so that's the same thing as by breaking up the fraction as the conditional probability of E1 subject to F plus E2 conditioned to F. So what have we concluded? We've concluded, let me save the screen. Well, let me wait on saving the screen. So we've concluded that the probability of E1 union E2, assuming they're mutually exclusive, conditioned to F is the probability of E1. Let me erase that and put it down here. Sorry. So let me summarize what we just did. The probability of E1 union E2 conditioned to F is given by the sum. It breaks up as a sum. It's additive, in other words. Okay. All right. Now let's consider the next case. So there's a special case of the previous formula, which goes like this. Let E be that event, any event, and then we have E complement. And E complement is the empty event, so we can apply the formula to that situation. And we see, notice that E union E complement is S. So the probability of S conditioned to F is the probability of E union E complement conditioned to F, which is the same thing as the probability of E conditioned to F plus the probability of E complement conditioned to F. Now we saw in the first formula that the left-hand side is 1. So that tells us that the probability of E complement conditioned to F is 1 minus the probability of E conditioned to F. So that's another formula that I want to consider. And the last thing I want to say is this, is if we have a bunch of events, pairwise mutually exclusive, so that means EI intersect DJ is empty if I is not J, then the probability, a similar argument shows the probability of the union of all the events conditioned to F breaks up as a big sum. I goes from 1 to N of the probability of EI conditioned to F. And that, I believe, is all for now. So as you've seen today, that's all there is to it with condition for section 3.2. We're going to move on next time to talk about more difficult notions, one of which is called Bayes' formula.